Thank you. There's a little, as you're going through your day, reach out, give them a word, you know, just keep them in your prayers because they're going through a hard time right now. With that, if everyone will just join me in prayer. Creator God, thank you so much for being in our lives. Thank you for being here with us today. Lord, we ask that you lift each of us up today. Help us find your grace and your word in everything that we do and everything that we see and witness, Lord. Help us celebrate today and every day, all that you do and have done for us and are doing for us. It is in your name we pray. Amen.
Good morning and welcome to worship at First Baptist Church. It is a beautiful day to be in the house of the Lord together and wonderful to celebrate the waters of baptism this morning. So I welcome at this time Walter Stallings as the candidate for baptism. This is Walter. Many of you have had a chance to get to know him over the past few months, came a few months ago to rededicate his life to the Lord and also become a member of this fellowship of faith. And so Walter was baptized at a young age, but has in this rededication of his life to the Lord, he would like to do so going through the waters of baptism again. You know, the name Walter, there's two Walters in the baptismal pool this morning. I don't know if that will ever happen again. But the name Walter means Lord of the Army. It's a pretty cool name. You know? And it's fitting that, the men and families should rise up to the occasion to be the leaders in family. And so as Walter has shared with me what God has been doing in his life over the past few months and his desire to be an even better husband and an even better father and leader within the community, I celebrate the work that the Lord has been doing and will continue to do in his life. And it is my pleasure today, Walter, to baptize you as a sign of this recommitting of your life to Jesus Christ. So I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. You were buried with him in baptism, and you're raised with Christ to new life. Will you help me celebrate? Yeah. Now I ask you if you would join your hearts in prayer with me as we pray a prayer over Walter and upon his family and upon his future as he continues to give his life to the Lord daily. Father, we thank you so much for the work that you began long ago in Walter Stallings' life. We thank you for the work that you have continued and what is to come. Now, Lord, we know that as we seek to be the men who are after your heart, the men who make a difference in our community, the men who make big differences in our families, the pathway to do that is in following you, giving our lives to you. So we celebrate the recommitment that Walter has made. We celebrate all that you are going to do in his life, the way that he is going to minister to us and share love and grace and peace, and the way that you are going to share great love and movement of yourself, your Holy Spirit, through his life. So we give you thanks for him, and we celebrate this day the decisions that have been made that will mark his life forever. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
This morning I'll be reading the Old Testament, Isaiah 42, 1 through 9. Here is my servant whom I uphold, my chosen one, in whom I delight. I will put my spirit on him, and he will bring justice to the nations. He will not shout or cry out or raise his voice in the streets. A bruised reed will not break, and a smoldering wick he will not snuff out. In faithfulness he will bring forth justice. He will not falter or be discouraged till he establishes justice on earth. In his teaching, the islands will put their hope. This is what God, the Lord, says, the creator of the heavens, who stretches them out, who spreads out the earth with all that springs from it, who gives breath to its people, and life to those who talk on it. I, the Lord, have called you in righteousness. I will take hold of your hand. I will keep you. I will make you to be a covenant for the people and a light for the Gentiles, to open eyes that are blind, to free captives from prison, and to release from the dungeon those who sit in darkness. I am the Lord, that is my name. I will not yield my glory to another or my praise to idols. See the former things I have taken place, and new things I declare. Before they spring into being, I announce them to you. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Comes from Matthew 3:13-17, the baptism of Jesus. Then Jesus went from Galilee to the Jordan River to be baptized by John, but John tried to talk him out of it. "I am the one who needs to be baptized by you," he said, "so why are you coming to me?" But Jesus said, "It should be done, for we must carry out all that God requires." So John agreed to baptize him. After his baptism, as Jesus came up out of the water, the heavens were opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and settling on him. And a voice from heaven said, "This is my dearly loved Son, who brings me great joy." This is the word of the Lord. Praise his holy name. Now, if I can have all the kids come down to the front, please. Good morning. Separate. Go ahead. Luke. Come sit with Miss Christy, Luke. Levi or Luke, one of y'all. Sit down right here. All right. I'm going to show you guys some pictures. This. You see him? Let's see if I can turn it there. You see him? This is my nephew. When he was, this is the day he was born. Oh, wrong way. There's another one. That's him getting a little bit older. He's probably maybe a couple weeks older at that one. Oh, we're getting a few months older now. A little bit older now, we're probably in a year or two. Oh, we got a little bit older. And now I'm going to jump, because if I showed you all my pictures of, and that was just a little bit of my pictures of my nephew, I have a whole lot more. This is what he looks like today. He just turned 13 back in October. He's grown up a lot, hasn't he, since that first picture I showed you. I'm going to show you another picture. I'm going to blow it up a little bit. See this picture? You see him in this picture? He's the one right in the center of the picture. You see him? He's the one right there in the center wearing that kind of aqua-colored shirt. Do you know what's special about this picture, other than the whole family's in this picture? But why do you think this picture is important to us? I'm going to show you my next picture. What is he doing in this picture? He's getting baptized. That picture I just showed you was that day. We were celebrating him giving his life to the Lord. And just like Mr. Walter did just a few minutes ago, that's what Evan did that day. And we were all there to witness and celebrate, just like your family, Mr. Walter's family, is here today to celebrate. It is one of the most important days of someone's life when they get baptized. And you can see all my pictures at that point. But that day is a day of celebration because it's a day of new life. Just like we've got a new year starting, it's a new part of our life starting when we get baptized. It's us saying that we're going to dedicate the rest of our life to Jesus. And everything we do from that point on is in Jesus' name and for Jesus. So it's a big changing point for all of us. Everyone who's been baptized goes through that. And we've been changed because we now have a heart full of Jesus and we live for him. So that's why baptism is important. It's us declaring that we love the Lord and we're going to be with him forever. And that's why today is a day to be celebrated, because we witnessed a new beginning for Mr. Walter. And it's an amazing thing to see. And when you guys go through it, or if you've already been through it, it's an amazing day for you too, for everybody who goes through it. So remember, when you make the commitment, and it's a very, very important commitment because it starts a whole new life for you, because it's a very important commitment, it's the best thing you could do to choose to follow Christ. All right, let's pray. Creator God, thank you so much for the decision that Mr. Walter made today to follow you. Help us to understand the importance of why that decision is so important, and to let us live each and every day in your name and following the path that you set for us. Lord, help us keep you in our hearts each and every day. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Please stand and join us.
As Holly shared with you earlier, this morning Kenny Bryan passed, and I found out on my way up here to the church and swung by and spent a little time with her, and her sister Rhonda was there, and Shelby is requesting right now to not have any visitors today and such. She has family that is there with her, but we want to be praying for her. And I feel like I didn't know Kenny, I'm sure, as well as many of you did, but I feel his loss, and I feel the loss of a friend, a man who was very easy to speak with, make you feel loved, make you feel heard. And he went through a whole lot. I believe in early 2019 is when many of his health battle began. Y'all know he went through a whole lot. And the past year has been especially difficult with cancer. So we celebrate that he is healed, because he is. But it still stings. Missing a brother is a thing that's hard to sometimes come to terms with. So as we go to the Lord this morning, we think about the Bryan family. We also want to be thinking about Angie Evans and her family. Her father, Billy Ray Harrell, passed on Wednesday, and his funeral and celebration of life was yesterday. And so we were able to celebrate him. This afternoon, we'll be celebrating Joe Fields' life with the Fields family. You've heard that Al Morris passed back before Christmas. I want to continue to be in prayer for that family, the Morris family, Laura and Julie and Cindy as well. Right now, our church cast is not functional, and we're trying to get that up to speed, but it's a technology issue on that company's side. So please pay attention to the Facebook feed. That's where we're trying to post some of the details of services and everything. And when we find out information for Kenny Bryan, we will post that there. But I know there's a lot going on, carrying a lot of things right now, a lot of people being carried in our hearts. So as we have a time of prayer, I want to invite you into that. And for the first minute or so, just where you're at, I want to invite you to pray silently, and then I will conclude with our pastoral prayer. So let us pray. Father, we give you thanks for your closeness in these moments and in every moment that we walk through in life. You have promised your presence to be with us, so there is no place that we can separate ourselves from you, from your love. We thank you that if we have given ourselves to you, that you are there. There is no amount of sin that we can get ourselves entangled in, that when we turn to you, you're not right there to hold us, to comfort us, and to guide us through and out of. Lord, we thank you especially for the ways you are there with those who are mourning and grieving right now. Lord, we pray that your presence would be felt with Shelby right now, as she is dealing with all of the emotions and that are flooding her mind right now, and the fears of what lay ahead without Kenny. We know of how inseparable they have been, and the love of each other's lives, and we know that the days ahead are not going to be easy. But we also know that you're with her. You're going to comfort her. And she has a wonderful family there by her, and a family of faith that will battle with her through anything. We pray for Amy and Scott and Avery and Kayla. We pray that your peace would be upon their family, as they know that their father and grandfather and father-in-law is not in the pain that he has dealt with for these past many years. that he is healed, that he is restored, that he has finished the race, and he has looked into your eyes, and you have said, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." Lord, we think about Angie and their family. Is they also have celebrated her father's life this weekend, and although his homecoming with you is difficult on this side of eternity, we know of the peace that you're continuing to give to their family, to Aideen and everyone, and we pray that it would continue. Lord, we pray this for the Fields family and for the Morris family on the loss of Joe and the loss of Al, and as they in the days ahead and today celebrate their lives, just pray that you would continue to pour yourself out in every measure, in every measure and fullness of love and of peace and of joy. We know that the path of mourning and grief is a path that is blessed. There wouldn't be mourning and grief if we weren't loved deeply and if we didn't love deeply. And so it's a sign of what we have experienced and the fullness of what we experience. And so we have to traverse that path. And as we do that, we find that over time you take that sting away and you replace it with all of your good gifts. And we just pray this for these families. We pray for people who are dealing with other illnesses and disease and in various trials and tribulations. We pray that you would lead and you would guide and direct. As always, I pray that this church family would not only lift brothers and sisters up in prayer, but that we would seek opportunities to be the hands and feet of Christ in other people's lives and to come alongside of them. So we thank you for what you're doing. We thank you for this past season of Thanksgiving and Christmas that we've experienced. And now as we move into a new year and the new possibilities and excitement for what is ahead, we pray that you would give us joy at all the things you are doing in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
is returning to sit with the congregation, I'd like to invite you to say hello to the folks around you, and when the music has stopped playing, that's a sign to come back to your seats. Go one more stanza. It is fitting that today we celebrate baptism, as within the Christian church calendar, the first Sunday after the Epiphany, which was this past Friday, that Sunday is traditionally known as the Baptism of the Lord Sunday. We go real quick from Jesus being born to celebrating his baptism, but it all works within the calendar year, and so As I was talking with Walter back before Christmas and asking him when he thought he might like to schedule the baptism, we settled on the day, and when I went to looking, I said, that's going to work perfectly. And so I love baptism Sundays, and it always causes me to revisit my baptism. I don't know about you. I was 8 years old when I was baptized, and so I can remember some features of it. And I'll share that in a moment. But if you would, wherever you're at, you're sitting here today, just kind of recall in your mind, if you're able to. And for some of you, that might have been, you might tell me later, I don't know if I can think back that far. But you can laugh in church. Y'all remember my last sermon was a stand-up comedy. Y'all remember that one? Okay. Not today. You have to watch the tape. If you're wondering, you have to just go look back on Facebook or YouTube. You can find the tape on that one. But anyway, where was I at? Oh, yeah. So, thinking about our baptism and the holiness of that moment and everything, again, it's fitting that today we celebrate in the waters of baptism. The scripture passage that goes along with this Sunday within the lectionary text, just again, everything works really well, and so I'm excited to preach about this. It comes from Acts chapter 10, verse 34, where Peter begins, he's basically preaching this sermon. But if we just start at 34, which I'll read it now, he says in verse 34, Peter starts speaking, he says, I now realize how true it is that God does not show favoritism, but accepts from every nation the one who fears him and does what is right. So to get to why he says that, let's back up just a little bit, and I'm going to read some of the Bible. It's not going to be on the screen, but I just want you to kind of hear the words. I kind of want to guide us through the narrative here, the account of Peter and Cornelius. And so it begins at Acts chapter 10 with verse 1, where Luke, who's the author of both Luke and Acts, if you want to read a couple books in the Bible, in the New Testament, that go together, start with Luke and then go straight into Acts. And you're reading what the physician Luke writes as his account hearing from first-hand eyewitnesses of Jesus, and then his first-hand account of the early church and its growth in Acts. And so this is what Luke writes. He says, at Caesarea there was a man named Cornelius, a centurion in what was known as the Italian regiment. What you need to hear there is that Cornelius is not a Jew, okay? So the original hearers of this, like we hear it and we're like, all right, the dude's probably got some sweet armor because he's a centurion. He's from Italy. He probably likes, you know, spaghetti. You can laugh. I don't know if spaghetti was invented then. But he's from the Italian regiment. His name is Cornelius, and he works for Caesar, for Rome. And the scripture goes in verse 2, he and all his family were devout and God-fearing. He gave generously to those in need, and he prayed to God regularly. One day at about 3 in the afternoon, he had a vision. He distinctly saw an angel of God who came to him and said, Cornelius. Cornelius stared at him in fear. What is it, Lord? He asked. The angel answered, your prayers and gifts to the poor have come up as a memorial offering before God. Now send men to Joppa to bring back a man named Simon, who is called Peter. He is staying with Simon the tanner, whose house is by the sea. When the angel who spoke to him had gone, Cornelius called two of his servants and a devout soldier who was one of his attendants. He told them everything that had happened and sent them to Joppa. Okay, so the Lord comes to a man who's a Gentile, who is not Jewish, a man who is a centurion, who works for the people who oppress the Jewish people. And the Lord comes and tells him to send for a man named Simon, who is also called Peter, and this man is a Jew. Peter has a vision about this time. Okay, Luke's putting a few different scenarios and experiences here together. So just as God is working in Cornelius' life, Cornelius is devoted to the Lord. He is God-fearing. He is seeking the Lord. The scriptures say here that he gives offerings. He supports other people, supports the needs in his community. Now, Peter is having a vision, okay? At about noon the following day, as they were on their journey and approaching the city, Peter went up on the roof to pray, because that's a good spot to pray, right? Get up on the roof. He became hungry, though, and he wanted something to eat. And while the meal was being prepared, he fell into a trance. Okay, does that happen to anybody? Any of you guys, your wife's cooking, and you're so hungry, you just fall into a trance, right? Now, we normally grab a Snickers bar or something like that. The Bible says here, though, if you want a vision from the Lord, get hungry and start seeking him while your wife is cooking. Apparently, that's what you need to get a word from the Lord. But it works here, okay? So imagine he's up on the roof, he's praying. And it wasn't, you know, we see this throughout the scriptures. We see that the early believers, that they would find this place, this secret place. Jesus talked about finding the secret place of going and praying and seeking the Father, seeking him in silence, getting away from the distractions. For us, he would say, put your cell phone on do not disturb, leave it in another room, go to a separate place and have some time with the Lord. So Peter's in this trance. And then in verse 11, the Bible says that he saw heaven open and something like a large sheet being let down to earth by its four corners. It contained all kinds of four-footed animals as well as reptiles and birds. Okay, what he is seeing here is a vision of the grocery store. All right, they didn't have grocery stores like we had today. You're walking by a field, you see a bunch of goats, some sheep. You're like, okay, this is where we go to get our food. Everybody tracking with me? Good, okay. And so he's hungry, he has a vision, the sheet comes down, and it's like a buffet, right? They tell us not to eat it, like the K&W is extinct now, right? The Golden Corral, they say, it's not good for us to go to the Golden Corral and just pile a plate up, okay? It's not good for our hearts and everything, okay? For the Jewish people, there was laws that governed what they could eat and what they could not eat. There were ceremonial clean and unclean foods. And so for Peter, he was a very strict and devout Jew. There were rules about who he could associate with. He was not supposed to associate with Gentile people based on the Jewish tradition. And again, this is not a tradition so much that God gave to them. This is a tradition that Pharisees had made law upon law that they thought made them holy and righteous and devout, and yet it separated them from God and from people. That's why Jesus was not so hard on the people who were sinful, who were lost, who were prisoners in their sin. He was the hardest on the people who thought they had it all together, yet they were prisoners of their own making. Oh, me. Somebody say, oh, me. Oh, me, because I don't remember exactly where I was. But it was, oh, yeah, okay. So this is exciting. The sheet comes down. It contains all kind of four-footed animals as well as reptiles and birds. Then a voice told him, Peter, get up. Kill and eat. It's dinner time. Surely not, Lord. It didn't say dinner time in there, but sure, I added that. Surely not, Lord, Peter replied. I have never eaten anything impure or unclean. The voice said to him a second time, do not call anything impure that God has made clean. This happened three times, and immediately the sheet was taken back to heaven. While Peter was wondering about the meaning of the vision, the men sent by Cornelius found out where Simon's house was, and they stopped at the gate. They called out, asking if Simon, who was known as Peter, was staying there. While Peter was still thinking about the vision, the Spirit said to him, Simon, three men are looking for you. So get up and go downstairs. Do not hesitate to go with them, for I have sent them. Peter went down and said to the men, I'm the one you're looking for. Why have you come? The men replied, we have come from Cornelius the centurion. He's just had the vision, okay? God's told him, don't call stuff, you know, unclean that God has made clean. God does this continual thing of all the disciples. I mean, God's doing the most through Peter over and over and over. Just Peter kept stepping into it, right? He kept messing up. He was the one who's known for consistently being inconsistent. You know, he tells Jesus in one voice, I will go to the cross and die with you, or I'll go through anything and die with you. And then the next minute, you know, Jesus said, no, you're going to deny me before the rooster crows in the morning three times, and he does. You know, this is who Peter is, yet he keeps after it, right? He keeps pressing through. He keeps trying to grow, trying to get it right. And so the first thing that we should hear that Peter hears here is there is a man who is a Gentile here who is not a Jew, and he wants to talk to you. He wants to associate with you. He is a righteous and God-fearing man, though, these men tell him, who is respected by all Jewish people. A holy angel told him to ask you to come to this house so that he could hear what you have to say. Then Peter invited the men into the house to be his guests. The next day, Peter started out with them, and some of the believers from Joppa went along. The following day, he arrived at Caesarea. Cornelius was expecting them and had called together his relatives and close friends. Again, relatives, they're not Jewish people. Close friends. As Peter entered the house, Cornelius met him and fell at his feet in reverence. Peter made him get up. Stand up, he said. I'm only a man myself. While talking with him, Peter went inside and found a large gathering of people. He said to them, you are well aware that it is against our law for a Jew to associate with or visit a Gentile, but God has shown me that I should not call anyone impure or unclean. You see what happened there? Originally, God said, don't say that anything. Verse 14, surely not, Lord, Peter replied. I have never eaten anything impure or unclean. The voice spoke to him a second time. Do not call anything impure that God has made clean. And then Peter, he adjusts his mindset and he says, but God has shown me that I should not call anyone impure or unclean. So when I was sent for, I came without raising any objection. May I ask why you sent for me? Cornelius answered, 3 days ago I was in my house praying. At this hour, at 3 p.m, suddenly a man in shining clothes stood before me and said, Cornelius, God has heard your prayer and remembered your gifts to the poor. Send to Joppa for Simon, who was called Peter. He is a guest in the home of Simon the Tanner, who lives by the sea. So I sent for you immediately, and it was good of you to come. Now we are all here in the presence of God to listen to everything the Lord has commanded you to tell us. Is the scene set for you pretty good here? You got it now? We're in Cornelius' home. His relatives, his friends have come. They have sent for Peter. Peter's been undergoing all this, and then Peter comes, and he's about to bring the message. And so that's where we're at. We're here, Acts chapter 10, verse 34 through 43. And this is the sermon that God gives to Peter to give to those who are in attendance. And Peter begins by saying, I now realize how true it is that God does not show favoritism, but accepts from every nation the one who fears him and who does what is right. You know the message God sent to the people of Israel, announcing the good news of peace through Jesus Christ, who was Lord of all. You know what has happened throughout the province of Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John preached. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power. How he went around doing good and healing all who were under the power of the devil because God was with them. We are witnesses of everything he did in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They killed him by hanging him on the cross, but God raised him from the dead on the third day and caused him to be seen. He was not seen by all the people, but by witnesses whom God had already chosen. You remember the disciples were witnesses. You remember the change that the disciples experienced. Remember the disciples scattered when Jesus was hung on the cross and murdered, didn't they? They ran. Peter disowned Jesus three times to a little girl that kept saying, he was with him. And he said, no, I wasn't, no. And then the rooster crows after the third time. But you remember when Jesus appears to them after having been killed, hung on a cross, put in the tomb, he resurrects, he appears to them, and every one of them are resolute in their devotion to the Lord. Everyone is successfully martyred except for John. They tried to boil him alive. They put him on the island of Patmos. He did die in his old age. Peter would end up being put on a cross. He didn't believe he was worthy enough to be hung with a cross like Jesus was, so the cross was turned upside down when he was martyred. Again, it says, he was not seen by all, but by the witness whom God had already chosen. We can put in there that they were resolute in their devotion to the Lord. He goes on, by us who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead, he commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one whom God appointed as the judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. So I'm going to pause there for a moment. And if you want to continue reading about this account, there are five more verses that go into to what people's reaction is to that. All the people who believed it, they were overjoyed at the invitation that they had been given to join what God was doing, and they were baptized, it says here. But I want to go back to verse 39, where Peter jumps into this sermon, and he starts preaching, and he begins with, you know, actually, in 34, he talks about how he now realizes how true it is that God doesn't show favoritism. What he's saying is that us people do. He's acknowledging that he did show favoritism in what he ate, that the people he thought were good and bad based on who they were and not on their character. But he starts talking about what Jesus did. In verse 37, he says, you know what has happened throughout the whole province of Judea, beginning in Galilee, after the baptism that John preached. This baptism began with John the Baptist. John the Baptist was out on the edges of Jerusalem, and people would go into this ascetic type environment, knowing that the trappings of the world were causing them to fall into sin. And this sin, like James, the brother of Jesus, tells us, this sin would drag people on. It would start building, you know, giving fruit, sinful fruit into their lives that didn't lead to life, but it led to death, separation from God, both now and for eternity, and punishment. And so people didn't want that anymore. So they would go to John, and John would talk to them about repentance, and then he would baptize them as a sign of the repentance that they were experiencing. Now, I asked you earlier to think about your baptism. And as we ask the question, what is baptism? Baptism is full immersion into a new way of living. Now, I know there's different traditions that, you know, we have Baptist in our name, so we got a pool in the church, and we go all the way under the water. All right, Walter, I made sure you got all the way under the water, okay? And, you know, I knew a pastor one time, the first church I served, and the first baptism I witnessed, he got the guy halfway down. It was a small baptismal pool, okay? I was telling Walter about this at the beginning. It was a small baptismal pool, and the first time I baptized someone in that pool, they were about this tall, okay? And I said, when you go down, you got to bend your knees down or you're going to hit the wall. And so I go down, and he doesn't bend his knees. And so he smacks against the wall. Then I drag him under the water. Because I had already seen about a month earlier, the pastor dunked somebody who was refusing. They were kind of standing strong, and they went under, but the whole top of the head didn't go under. So he made sure they went. So they came back up. He went down a second time and made sure he got them all the way under the water. Now I don't think that matters. I really don't. I think it's a beautiful, beautiful symbol. There are some traditions who sprinkle or put the, you know, the take water from, you know, in a holy basin, in a basin that's been blessed, and they put it as a symbol of the cross on the forehead. There's different traditions, but again, these are all symbols of something that has happened within the heart and the mind and the soul of a believer. Baptism is about renewal and regeneration. Theologically, baptism begins when one professes faith in Jesus Christ as the Lord, their Lord and Savior. Earlier I asked you, you think about when you were baptized. I remember at First Baptist Church being in the baptismal pool. Harry Edwards was the name the pastor at First Baptist Church, Scotland Neck. I remember my mom sitting on the front row, and the way the baptismal pool was, it was kind of set up on this side of the sanctuary, and my dad was the organist, but the organ was switched the other way because the choir loft was over there, so he would direct the choir and play the organ at the same. He was the music minister and organist. But I remember my dad had these little mirrors that he would position so he could see the pastor and everything. And I remember being in that baptismal pool. I remember Pastor Harry Edwards, getting ready to baptize me. And I remember coming up out of the water and the way I was positioned, immediately seeing those mirrors and seeing the joy on my dad's face. I remember seeing the joy from my mom and other family members who were there. But more importantly, I remember it was in February that I was baptized. I remember back the summer before at Vacation Bible School. I remember that little chair that I was sitting in, and part of the Vacation Bible School, the associate minister at the time would come around and he would explain the gospel to the children. And I've been wondering for a long time, asking my dad a lot of questions about life and death, and where we go, and the consequences of sin and such. And my parents would passionately and carefully and gently share the gospel with me, not in the way that it manipulated me into making any decision, but so that I understood, and that if I wanted to trust Jesus with my life, that I was doing it carefully and I was counting the cost. And although a 7 and 8 year old, there's so much you can understand then and you grow into, I knew the decision that I was making. And I remember praying with that pastor, that associate minister in that room. I can take you right back to the very room and the very spot. The chair might not be there anymore. It was one of them little ones, little children's ministry chairs. But I remember sitting there, and I remember praying, giving my life to Jesus. I remember being baptized in that moment. I remember my full immersion into following Jesus. I remember that later that week, on the final night of Vacation Bible School, walking the aisle. I tried to be the first one to walk the aisle, but there was a boy named Charles Cross. And I don't know where Charles Cross lives now, but I remember walking and trying to get out of that aisle, and he said, "Stop touching me!" And I had to walk back. And then Peggy Whitehead was the first one to go down. And so, but then I got around Charles Cross. I said, "You're not going to hold me from the Lord." And I went down, and I made my public profession of faith in Jesus Christ. Okay? Am I processing it now? I might have some baggage there, okay? So I got to work through this stuff later. But I remember these things, and they were so important in my life. Baptism, being fully immersed in this new way of living. I didn't just hear about Jesus and say, "Yeah, that'll probably be a good option if I get into some bad trouble one day and choose Christ." I wanted Him. I wanted the renewal. I wanted to be washed clean of my sin. And I knew it wasn't that. I mean, this water's from the town of Farmville. We'll pay for it later and everything. But it's a symbol. That water doesn't save anybody. It's the giving of our life to Jesus. But oh my goodness, that's a powerful, powerful, powerful symbol of what's going on in our life. It's vital for us to live our baptism. That's something I want to talk about today. I know you're thinking, "Dang, this is going to be a long sermon." So I'm going to try to go through these. I have three things I want to say, okay? And I didn't expect to spend that much time in the build-up to it and talk about Cornelius, but I think it's important, okay? I think the Lord wanted me to say some of those things and to show you what Peter had been through. See, it's vital for us to live a baptism kind of life. And I first heard this when I was in seminary. And I was like, I don't know. I've always been taught, you get baptized, that's it. You get to go to heaven one day. And the professor said, "Oh, it's so much more. It's so much more. You're entering into relationship with Jesus." It's vital for us to continue living our baptism because it is how we build relationship with God. John 15, 9 through 17 says that, "As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you." This is Jesus. He says, "Remain in my love." Some translations of the scripture say, "Abide in my love." He says, "If you keep my commandments, you will remain or abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and remain in His. I have told you this so that your joy may be complete, and that my joy and your joy may be complete. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no other than this, than to lay one's life down for one's friends." Did you hear the words I said as I baptized my brother Walter this morning? I said, "You were buried with Him in baptism, and you were raised with Him to new life." That is what baptism is like. That is what the relationship with Christ is like. We are buried with Him in baptism. We have communion with Him in giving our lives to Him. That is how we build a relationship with Jesus. There is no relationship unless we give of ourselves to the Lord. I've told you this before. I can't have a relationship with my wife unless I give myself to that relationship. I can't have a relationship with my church unless I give myself to this community of faith. That's one of the reasons that as we came here, our desire was to live in this town, not to live on the outskirts. I mean, we'd love to have like 20, 30 acres out. I could set up a good spot to kill some big bucks, you know. I might put a big fence around there and see, you know, I can get Rick to help me out. We'll figure out how we can grow them big. And Alec probably helped me out with that as well. We'll get some good genetics in there. You know, I'm rambling a little bit now, but it's more important for us to be part of this community. It's more important for us to devote ourselves and to abide and to remain and to be here, to know what you feel, to know what you're going through. That's how we build relationship. It is not easy for me. I think I'm an extrovert, but I'm like a low-level extrovert. And so I could probably function most of the time by just hanging out by myself, although I enjoy being around other people. So it's always been, especially early in my ministry, like to go and do pastoral care type stuff, it's always been a little bit of jumping outside of a comfort zone. And it's become easier and easier and easier to do those things because there's such a reward when you give yourself in community to other people. When you give yourself to others, when you try to bless them with your presence and with your love, you get so much more blessing in return. So it's vital to continue living our baptism because that's how we build relationship. It's vital to continue to live out the baptism type of life because it's how we overcome sin. Romans 6, 1 through 4, Paul writes that, "What shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning that grace may increase?" Now, that's a point of view some people have. I come to Jesus, He's going to forgive me of my sins so I can do whatever I want to. Is that love? No. He says, "By no means. We are those who have died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? Or don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into His death? We were therefore buried with Him through baptism into death in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life." Baptism is all about repentance. It's how we overcome sin. I read all that stuff about Peter and Cornelius because this is born out of his experience of all. It's like a re-baptism, a re-immersion into the mind and the heart of God that he experienced that helped him overcome the shortcomings of his ministry. He wasn't being fully loving to the people that he needed to be loving to. I talked to you about the way he went from anything being impure and unclean to linking that to, you know, this is really about how I treat anyone. And so, you know, for you that could be an issue. It might be some sort of other thing that you're going through and you're like, how am I going to get around this? How am I going to get through this? You know, you can Google up a blog on about anything on how to help you. But the real healing that you'll experience is in giving your life to Jesus and trusting Him and walking with Him through it. That's how we overcome sin. We repent. We die to it. And then we live new life in Christ. It's vital to live our baptism because it's our path to purpose in God's kingdom. Luke 9, 23 through 25, Jesus says to the disciples, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me will save it. What good is it for someone to gain the whole world and yet lose or forfeit their very self?" That's that old classic, the first shall be last, and the last shall be first. You know, I have a lot of conversations with people, and I've never had a conversation with a person who says, I just kind of want to skate through life and not make any difference. I kind of want to die one day and just like everybody just can forget about me and I can be gone. No, God's put it in every one of our souls, this desire that we want to have a purpose, that we want to have a legacy. We know a lot of people who have legacies and have purposes, but how beautiful is the purpose that will endure for eternity, the purpose that lies within the kingdom of God. It's a beautiful way of living to find the purpose that God has for us. The way that God has uniquely crafted us and put these vessels, you know, these bodies that we have that He's entrusted to us, and the skills that they're able to, you know, some of y'all are good at dancing. Some of y'all are good at hitting golf balls or doing any number of things and various things, and you're kind of proficient in it because God gave you this body to have the aptitude to do that. But that's not who you are. Behind that, you're leaders. Behind that, you're healers. You're people who are able to go and be a presence, the presence of Jesus in other people's lives. That's our true purpose. Amen? That is our purpose. You know, how beautiful is it to find a purpose that we can live our whole lives? And that's the call that God gives us. And the way that we find that is to give our lives to Him. We are to be a community of faith who lives out our baptism with great love and courage until our baptism is complete. That's the first thing I thought when I heard about Kenny this morning. His baptism is complete. He is fully, fully immersed in the presence of Jesus Christ. Billy Ray Harrell is fully immersed in His presence. Joe Fields is fully immersed. Al Morris, and those others who we carry in our hearts and minds, those people we've lost in our lives. And one day the blessing of living a baptism kind of life is that we will experience that full immersion. So would you join me in prayer now? Father, we thank You so much for the work Your Holy Spirit continues to do in our church and in our lives. We thank You for the covenant community that we are, that we walk alongside of each other and encourage one another and build each other up. And we thank You for the blessing of calling us together for this time and for these moments and for our future. We pray that Your work would continue. We pray that You would continue to raise up people to believe and trust in You and to bring them into this family of faith and to grow us and to grow our influence in the Farmville community and beyond, and that You would continue to shine brightly as Your kingdom comes on this earth. We long for the day when everything will be restored. We long for the day of the new order, the new heavens and the new earth, but we know that we're in the midst of that coming. And we can't control those sort of things, but we can control who we give our lives to. And so as we give our lives to You, I pray that daily we will find ourselves immersing ourselves more and more in relationship with You, in repenting of sin and choosing a righteous path, and in understanding what our purpose is on this earth. It's in the name of Jesus Christ that I pray. Amen. This morning we're going to have a hymn of response, and I'll be down here at the front to receive anyone who might want to make a decision this morning. Perhaps you have heard about baptism before, and you've maybe made a profession of faith before, and you've experienced newness of life in and through Jesus, but you haven't taken the steps to share that with a covenant community. I want to invite you this morning to come and share that with me and to be part of this family of faith. Maybe you've been hanging around the church for a while, and or maybe today's your first day here, and you say, you know what, I want this to be my church home. There isn't anything special you have to do other than come and say that, you know, that's what I want to do. I have faith in Jesus, and this is where I want my church home to be. Or maybe this morning you want to come to the altar area and to pray. Our hymn of response is Trust and Obey, and that's a good one, brothers and sisters. If you haven't heard it before, as we're singing it, listen to those words and follow how the Spirit leads you. Johnny's real good at that organ, and he can keep playing over and over, and we can do, you know, we can have an altar. So if you want to come here and pray, look, we don't have to be rushed out to lunch. It's 11:38, okay? Lunch is at 12. We got a little while. Let's spend time with the Lord. I love y'all, and if anyone wants to come this morning to share anything, I'll be at the front to receive you. ask Walter to come back up to the front. As he's coming, I want to say a word of thanks to Gene Martin for bringing the word last week. It was a good word, and we were blessed by it. And thank you for kicking off 2023 with a good word. Also, just a reminder that Wednesday evenings start back this Wednesday. And so maybe if you haven't, in maybe this past fall, come to Wednesday evenings and you're available and would like to come have a good meal, some good fellowship, and a good Bible study, I'd like to invite you to check it out. The information is right there in the bulletin. We would like you to let us know in the office, though, by noon tomorrow to put you on the list. I believe the cost was like $8 per for an adult and children under four. Anyway, ask somebody. Call the office. And Nell will tell you, it's pretty affordable, and it's a really good meal, and it's great fellowship and great to be together. And once again, remember this afternoon at 2 p.m. we'll be meeting in here for celebrating Joe Fields and being with her family. And following that, there will be a visitation and fellowship in the fellowship hall. Walter, I want to give you a gift on behalf of our church this morning, and I have a certificate here. I'll leave these here so you don't have to have your hands full. I'm going to ask you also to stay here so folks can come give you hugs and high fives and pound whatever you do want to do, you know, this morning. But we celebrate with you, brother. Love you and your family, and love this. I just love everybody. I mean, it's just, you know I'm a grown man telling other grown men that I love you, but we need that in the world. Amen. And that's who we're supposed to be. And so, you know, as we go through the days ahead, it's blessed to be part of a family like that. So let us pray. Father, we thank you so much for what we receive from you in relationship with you. We thank you that as we live a baptism kind of life, not just going through the waters of baptism at the beginning of our journey with you, but continue to live that kind of life, we thank you that it leads us closer to you and it helps us become the people you've called us to be. We celebrate Walter today and are so thankful for the commitment he has made to you and pray a continued blessing upon him and his family. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And may you go in peace. Amen.